The most common indication for creation of an arteriovenous, AV, fistula is renal failure requiring chronic hemodialysis. It is preferable to create a native fistula, although prosthetic material may be needed if a suitable vein is not available. The goal is to place an AV fistula prior to the patient starting dialysis. The day of surgery, electrolytes should be checked to verify the absence of hyperkalemia. Many of the patients are diabetic and close monitoring of blood glucose levels during the procedure is warranted. Antibiotic prophylaxis is administered within 1 hour of the incision. A single dose is usually sufficient. In patients with a poorly defined superficial venous system, venous mapping may be done preoperatively to define the anatomy. The patients requiring chronic hemodialysis are poor risks for general anesthesia. An axillary block on the side that is to be used provides excellent regional anesthesia. If regional anesthesia cannot be done, local anesthesia is a valid option. The patient is placed in the supine position. The arm to be used for the fistula is placed on an arm board, figure 1. The opposite arm may be tucked with a sheet or placed. Hair is removed with clippers. The arm is prepped circumferentially from the fingers to the axilla, figure 2. After draping, a sterile knit stocking is placed over the arm. The covers the fingers and arm to the axilla. The surgeon palpates the radial pulse. The location of the incision is planned, figure 3. A vertical incision is made in the forearm close to the wrist and lateral to the radial pulse, figure 4. Once the incision is carried to the deep subcutaneous tissue, self-retaining retractors are placed. Sharp and blunt dissection are used to identify the cephalic vein. The vein is skeletonized for a distance of 2 to 3 centimeters. It is encircled with vessel loops proximally and distally. Side brushes of the vein are ligated with 4 to 0 silk, figure 5. The radial artery is then dissected for a distance of 2 to 3 centimeters. There is a vein on either side of the radial artery that may be ligated or freed from the artery. The artery is encircled with vessel loops proximally and distally. Side brushes are ligated as necessary with 4 to 0 silk. Both vessels must be freely mobilized to enable a tension-free anastomosis. The artery and vein are then encircled with a single vessel loop both proximally and distally to allow alignment of the structures. Figure 6. A longitudinal venotomy is made in the cephalic vein with a number 11 blade and extended for 1 cm with iris scissors. The vein is dilated to size 3.5 mm and a cephalic catheter is passed cephalad to ensure patency of the vein. The vein is irrigated with heparinized saline, figure 7. The patient is administered intravenous heparin. Fine curved or straight bulldog clamps are placed proximally and distally on the radial artery. A longitudinal arterotomy of 1 cm is made. In some cases the artery may be much calcified and it will be necessary to probe the artery proximally to ensure patency. Once patency is established, the proximal bulldog clamp is reapplied. The artery and vein are aligned side to side. Anastomosis is then created between the cephalic vein and the radial artery using running 6 to 0 non-absorbable monofilament sutures. The needle on the arterial side must be passed from the endothelial surface outward, ensuring the endothelium is tacked down, figures 8 and 9. Needle B, figure 8, is passed back into the lumen and then run continuously on the back wall, always beginning into the arterial intima. At the end, it is tied externally to one arm of suture, figure 10. Once the anastomosis is nearly complete, the proximal bulldog clamp is released transiently to ensure enflowing to flush out any clot. The distal bulldog is likewise released to ensure back bleeding and clear any clot and debris, figure 11. The suture is then tied. The vessel loops are released on the vein and the distal and proximal bulldog clamps are removed from the radial artery. The vein proximal to the anastomosis is then palpated for a thrill to determine patency. Absence of a thrill may indicate a technical problem and the anastomosis should be re-explored. This is done by making a small venotomy in the cephalic vein distal to the anastomosis and a dilator is used to explore the anastomosis as well as the artery and vein. It is important to ligate the cephalic vein distal to the anastomosis, usually with double 2 to 0 silk, figure 12. After ligation, the vessel is transected, as this releases any tension on the anastomosis and reduces the incidence of venous hypertension of the hand. The presence of a thrill is re-verified. Hemostasis is achieved and the subcutaneous layers are closed with interrupted 3-0 absorbable suture. The skin is closed with a running subcuticular 4-0 absorbable suture. A sterile dressing is then placed. The patient is discharged the day of the procedure. If needed, dialysis is continued by the temporary access achieved prior to the operation. Occasionally, a venous side branch creating diversion of flow may need ligation. It usually takes 6 weeks for the arteriovenous fistula to mature and be ready to be used for hemodialysis.